The final one before a 5-week summer break, meaning momentum is crucial this weekend at the historic TT Circuit Assen. The Dutch TT is upon us. We can go back right to the start of Grand Prix motorcycle racing history in 1949 for the very first TT Assen. And here we are celebrating yet another in this long line of history. Always delivers one of the finest circuits on the planet. Fast, flowing, offers absolutely everything. And it very, very rarely disappoint. So we come into this weekend with it tight at the top in the championship, thanks to the efforts of Jorge Martin just 1 week ago in Germany. Now he has declared himself as Pecco Bagnaia's closest title contender, thanks to victory in both the sprint and the Grand Prix. Jack Appleyard and Simon Crafar here with you ahead of the summer break for one final time to talk to you exactly what we can look forward to this weekend in the Netherlands, plus all of the big talking points following the German Grand Prix. And let me guarantee you, there are quite a few for us to get stuck into. But Simon, the first one we have to start with is that of Jorge Martin. 1 week ago on this very show, we were saying the one thing that we needed to see from Jorge is to be able to string those results together week after week. And then he went and delivered a weekend like that. Victory in the sprint, victory in the Grand Prix, despite ever mounting pressure from the world champion Pecco Bagnaia. Are we right to say that he's declared himself as a title contender?
Well, yes, but I get nervous saying that so early, because things can turn around so fast in the championship, like very fast. You know, they've got to deal with so many different conditions. So riding on the edge all the time, so easy to make a mistake. So I hesitate to talk about championships so early when there's so many points. But I'm just really, really happy when I see, I said this on After the Flag, when I see a rider, especially a young rider, any rider, reach their potential, you know, even if they do it late. He's doing it, not late, about the third year in the championship, and he's delivering. And we knew how good he is, you know. And last year was a big disappointment. I think now it's why, I mean, it's a good thing when riders don't, it doesn't come too easy, because their head doesn't get too big too fast, you know. If they have to work for it, it forges their personality, makes them more resilient, and appreciate when they do have results like that. So I don't think it's a bad thing that he had a tough time last year. It's only going to make him stronger in the end. That's what I genuinely believe happens with all riders. And stronger he is. You know, he came under big pressure. And how confident he is on the bike. I mean, he's always been that fast, but under big pressure, losing the front on the first lap in the sprint. Remember that? After that double overtake. Coming under big pressure from Pecco. Amazing pressure from Pecco, and rode so defensively, pulled it off. So I can't say enough. I'm happy. You know, I get emotional when riders achieve their goals, potential. You see what we always knew they had in them, and they prove it. It's really nice to see.
What's the biggest difference in the Jorge Martin that we're seeing this year? Where have these results come from?
Well, all the things I was saying, it's his third year, obviously experience, but what I've seen at the start of this year is how hard he's worked for it. I mentioned in After the Flag show last week his determination training-wise. I mean, to me, that shows a lot, you know, how much the riders put into their preparation, because the riders that want it more put more preparation in, you know. Yeah. And it's because then they can roll up to the grid and they know they've done the preparation, they know they deserve the result, and there's something to be said for that, you know. It doesn't matter what sport, what era, it's the same, you know. And Jorge's the fittest he's been in his life. He's putting the hours in, so he knows he deserves it. And I think it's all part of being a winner, you know, and that's what he's doing. I hope he keeps it up.
It's now 6 podiums in a row for Jorge Martin. Just how concerned do you think Pecco Bagnaia will be by the momentum that he's gathering?
Well, I had planned to tell you that I think that even getting second, Pecco impressed me as much as he ever has. I think that's one of his...
Really?
Yes. Because watching it from rider point of view, but also I know his team will be seeing it, his opposition will be seeing it. He rode awesome. He did everything so right. It felt to me that he had things really in control. It was just the touch that made him not, made it not possible for him to win. But the other thing is he had such a rough sprint, meaning he wasn't competitive against Jorge in the sprint. It's a couple of people I've got to say that about. And he came back in the race the next day and had fixed all of that. And really, it was hard for Jorge to beat him. You know, he was very fast. So the way he managed it, the way he didn't, he obviously didn't fall off, but he didn't look like falling off. To me, it was probably the best ride that I've seen from Pecco, and that's including wins. It was awesome. To me, it's like he's maturing, he's growing into his championship. You know, at the beginning of the year, he looked a bit, yeah, you know, nervous about being the champion. To me, it's like that is going away, and this is the champion, you know what I mean? And he's showing why he's the champion.
Yeah, taking ownership of that number one plate and feeling like it belongs on that bike.
And he's comfortable with it, yeah.
It's, of course, the third season in a row now that Pecco's going to be embroiled in a title fight. Of course, on the losing end in 2021 to Fabio Quartararo. Had his duels again with Fabio last year, as well as Enea Bastianini in head-to-head battles. Now with Jorge Martin, what sort of a prospect, what sort of challenges will Jorge be posing to Pecco as we go into the second half of the year, if those two are to go head-to-head as we expect?
Okay, the thing about Jorge is he's brilliantly fast. You know, he's magic, and if he can stay on the bike, which now he is doing, you know, touch wood, then he's always going to be a threat, you know. From the other side, the reason I was so impressed with Pecco is the way he managed everything, you know, the pressure, the tyres, the... he manages everything so perfectly now that I think he has a confidence even up against Jorge, you know, because he's got more experience. He knows what Jorge doesn't know, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's what I feel. So I believe that Pecco is still the man to beat because of all that. He does know with a bit more time that Jorge's going to learn those things, and with the speed, he's going to be a danger. But that's how I see things at the moment.
Of course, Jorge was stressed to point out that the second half of the season does include a lot of circuits that he's been successful at in the past, not only in MotoGP, whether it be Silverstone, the Red Bull Ring, where, of course, he picked up his first Grand Prix victory, those races further afield as well. He had huge dominance in the Moto3 class. So it is set up like it could be a really intriguing title fight for many reasons. Of course, we've got, on a very base level, Italy versus Spain, and we've seen plenty of those battles in MotoGP down the years. A factory bike versus a satellite bike. Ducati's golden child, the one that they've plucked and wanted to win the championship, versus the one that was denied the opportunity to move to the factory team last year. It's set up to be a fascinating duel if it's to continue.
Yeah, and I think at some of those circuits you mentioned, Jorge's going to be so strong that Pecco is going to use what he's already told us he's learned to do, and that is just pick up 20 points. You know, when somebody's brilliantly fast, he used to push on and then fall. Just push to where you can go, take the 20 points, because hopefully they make a mistake, you know, when you're at your strong track. You see what I mean? I think that's where Pecco, I feel that's where he's matured and he'll manage it right. But you're right, Jorge's going to take some stopping. I mean, see how fast he was at Sepang last year. He was gone before he fell off.
That's the fight at the top of the championship. Martin versus Bagnaia expected to rumble on this weekend. But at the Saxon Ring last weekend, there was as much talk, as much noise about what was happening off track as well. Five crashes in the space of a weekend, the most that Marc Marquez has ever suffered in his Premier Class career, meant that he withdrew from the race, a circuit that he was unbeaten at on his 11 previous visits on Sunday morning. We didn't get the chance to speak to him or anybody from Honda for that fact on Sunday night after he decided to withdraw from the event. So this morning was the first opportunity to speak with the 8-time world champion, and here's what he had to say. Mark, obviously a bruising weekend, as you said yourself, just last weekend in the Saxon Ring. As you were leaving, you said you didn't feel ready to race. Do you feel ready now?
limit, but ready. I think that I will be ready to race, especially in Germany when I crashed in the warm up. The first hour I feel ready to go, but then passing the hours, passing the minutes, every time I feel more and more pain, especially on the ankle, on the fracture on the thumb. But then also I feel strange and was a crack also in the second rib. So this will be, I think, the most painful during this weekend. But we will try to start step by step, and let's see. It was important also to be here because two of the main riders in Honda are injured, like is Mir and Rins, that we wish the best for them. So Honda need bikes on track to improve for the future.
Of course, a weekend as difficult as that has got a lot of people talking about your future, 2024 in particular. Will you be with Honda next year at this current stage? What can you say?
Yeah, if I'm here, it's because my compromise with Honda is maximum, and I wanna work with them to improve the future, to improve our project. So I'm here to work with them.
But for next year, will you be with them still?
At the moment, of course, I'm here to work with them, and as I see, work with them for the future means next year project. This year will not change a lot the life. So the compromise is maximum.
Thanks, Mark. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Very quickly.
The words of Mark Marquez there. We just had him to do a couple of other bits afterwards, which is why I was trying to drag him back. Before we speak about his future and 2024 or 2025, whatever it may be, further injuries. We knew that he had broken his thumb, now a cracked rib as well, a circuit like Assen. How difficult is that going to make life for Mark?
Well, it's never easy to ride with injury at any circuit, but Mugello is a real physical one. So is Assen. Part of this is basically it's fast direction changes because the bike gets so heavy when it's fast with the aero, with a gyroscopic effect of everything spinning, super heavy from side to side. And to have an injury and try and do that, it's, you know, the last thing you want to do with an injury is going, you know, and try to get the bike and it'll be like a stab every time he does that, which is distracting, you know. So you do it a little bit slower and then the lap time's a little bit slower. So it's not going to be easy at all.
That, of course, the crash on Sunday morning at the Saxon Ring that forced him to withdraw. Simon, you've obviously an ex-rider. If you're in his position right now after five crashes in the space of a weekend, a circuit been so dominant at, what are you thinking? What are you doing?
Well, it's not natural for this man to do it, but if he's coming back here, you have to... I was thinking about this a lot after the last race in Saxon Ring, that that's very unlike Mark, isn't it? You know, the bike's tried to bite him so many times, he's had enough, you know, at that point. So I was thinking about coming in here, how you keep your motivation, which is what riders need to figure out before they go to every race. And if you know your bike's not competitive, you know, and you've just come from your favorite circuit and this has happened, you've got to take stock, and there'll be other people telling him this as well, people that care about him, people that are trying to protect him because they need their, you know, in the team, they need their investment protected, you know, not another injury. They'll be saying to him, look, you have to draw the line, get it to where, I mean, basically like Fabio and Franco do, get it to where the bike can, what it can do without doing that, and ride it. Just give up on trying to win. Let's aim at next year. And that's what I was thinking. The only way for a rider to be able to do that and forget about this year is to be able to focus on next year, making the bike better. But you've also got to remember that then they can't change the engine because the engine spec is, you know, the same. Aero is limited to one upgrade. So Honda I don't think they've used, this is off the top of my head, I don't think they've used this their upgrade. Yamaha have. So, I mean, for example, Yamaha are restricted to chassis changes, exhaust and inlet, and electronics. I mean, it's quite restrictive.
Yeah.
Honda have got one upgrade on the aero, and then they're the same, restricted to electronics, chassis, which they've already done dozens of. And, yeah, it's very limiting what they can do from here. So that is hard for a rider to swallow.
For sure, for sure. It's almost more fascinating sometimes what riders don't say in interviews like that. And Mark was very careful in what he said, didn't really speak about 2024. We have to remind you, he does have a contract in place with Honda for 2024. At this stage, Simon, do you think he'll still be there next year?
I have no idea. Your guess is as good as mine. You know, we could all guess. And really, I bet it's not done, you know. It's not decided. He'll want to see where it's going with Honda from the rest of, you know, the next weeks and what's on the table. But there's not a lot of spots on the table, is there? You know, very, there isn't any spots really, you know, there. And so your guess is as good as mine.
Just very quickly, we need to touch on Marco Bezzecchi. He's coming up in this press conference in a couple of minutes' time. Simon, it's been a tough period for him. It feels like he's just lost a little bit of momentum in that championship fight. Big weekend for him, though. Podium here last year. Do you think he can turn it around? What's been happening?
You know what? I still really believe in Marco. I really do. I thought he was the best rider that didn't get mentioned at Sachsenring. He turned it around from the sprint going, I couldn't make it turn. I couldn't, you know, then he came out in the GP and was fast. It was competitive, you know, and I think he's not going to go away. I think he's a great kid, great talent. And having Ducati behind him, that's what their Ducati strength is, that in numbers, is that when one rider, they're all open with their info. When one rider has a problem, they always fix it, make it better the next day because they can pull that info and go, you know what I'm saying? So Marco's not going to go away. He's had a little bit of bad luck with technical things. He's good.
Don't go anywhere. We've got a second press conference coming your way in about half an hour's time with Matt Marquez, Jack Miller and Johan Zarkabo. We kick things off with our very first, the top three men in the championship, Pecco Bagnaia, Jorge Martin and Marco Bezzecchi. Over to you, Matt Burt.